Grace View, and welcome to worship today. If today is your first time worshiping with us on site, please take a moment after the service to go to the visitors table at the foyer. One of our society stewards would love to meet you and connect with you and answer any questions you may have. On Sunday, the 2nd of October, you're invited to come along and join us for community worship. Everyone must come along, old and young at heart. Next Sunday, come along and join us and hear God has a gift, God has a plan. The personal testimony of our guest speaker from Jews for Jesus. Kindly also note, there will be a retiring offering after both morning services in support of the work of Jews for Jesus. If you've been recently bereaved, then Grief Share is the course for you. Starting on Tuesday nights at 6:30 here at the church from the 20th of September. If you'd like to attend this course, please contact Lael at the office for more information. Next Saturday the 24th is Heritage Day, and the Men at Work are hosting us to a day of fun, food and entertainment. Please make sure that you join us there. See you there. At Westview, we're about life change, and the courses we offer aim to do just that. Growing a relationship takes time, energy and dedication, and we'd like to invite you to join us for our new four-week course, Closer, as we journey through Richard Foster's Celebration of Discipline. For more information on this course, which starts on Saturday, the 8th of October, please contact James at the church office.
Hello friends, and welcome to worship. Our focus in worship today is on the human heart. And as we enter this time, I invite you to make the prayer that David prayed in Psalm 51, the prayer that he prayed for his own heart, I invite you to make that your prayer right now. Let us pray. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Amen. Let's worship God with pure hearts now.
Lord, I come to you, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. And Lord, I come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Lord, unveil my eyes, let me see you face to face. The knowledge of your love is to live in me. And Lord, renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life, in living every day, in the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Spirit leads me on the power of your love.
How did you manage to keep your heart open, Jesus? When your motives were questioned, when you were misunderstood, when your friends deserted you, when you saw your executioners mocking you, how did you keep your heart from growing cold and hard? How do you continue to keep your heart open now, Jesus? When your people so often get your message wrong, when we fight one another over small details of doctrine, when we are drawn away from your beauty, truth, and goodness so easily, how do you continue to love us and offer us your grace? We are hard-hearted people, God. We too easily allow the difficulties of this life to bruise, scar, and harden our hearts. We too easily turn away from soft-heartedness, from love and mercy and compassion. We too easily find excuses for failing to follow your example of guarding our hearts and following your way of love. In your open-hearted mercy, we ask you to forgive us. Remove our hearts of stone and replace them with hearts of flesh. And teach us how to live in this broken world as those with soft and open hearts. We praise you for your love, your grace, and your healing. And we celebrate the love we find in you, the soft-hearted, open-hearted God. Amen. Friends, when we are hurting and wounded, we tend to withdraw and withhold ourselves and our resources from others. When we get lost in the confusion and misinformation in our world, we tend to cling to what we have and what we know to feel safe. But these strategies only close our hearts and make them hard. In the face of polarization, fear, and difficulties, we need open hearts. We need our capacity to help one another and support each other. And one of the best ways we learn to keep our hearts open is to share what we have with others. When we give thoughtfully, prayerfully, generously, and intentionally, our hearts automatically open up and we connect more deeply with God and others. We recognize the goodness we enjoy and we find healing as we contribute in our own small way to healing our world. So as Westview's banking details come up on screen, let's use them to give generously and with soft and open hearts.
Let us pray. Father God, I just want to thank you for bringing us together today, Father. Father, as we come to learn about our hearts, Father, and what is important to God, them. Father God, I just pray that you take these tithes and offerings, Father, that they may go to do your work. Father, that we may one day be reunited with you in heaven. Pray this all in your holy name. Amen.
The reading comes from Proverbs 4, verses 20 to 27, and I'm reading from the New International Version. My son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ear to my words. Do not let them out of your sight. Keep them within your heart. For they are life to those who find them, and health to one's whole body. Above all else, guard your heart. For everything you do flows from it. Keep your mouth free of perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Give careful thought to the paths of your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or the left. Keep your foot from evil. Thanks be to God. His word.
Did you know that the number one cause of death amongst human beings globally, according to the World Health Organization, is heart disease? It's for this reason that a huge amount of time and money and energy goes into research to discover what makes for a healthy heart. Unlike previous generations, you and I are living in a time where we can benefit from all of the insights that flow to us from all of this research about the things that we can do to guard and to protect the health of our hearts. We know that certain foods contribute towards a healthy heart. We know that exercise, and sometimes types of exercise more than others, contributes to a healthy heart. We know that reducing the stress in our lives helps to keep our hearts healthy, having enough sleep, not smoking. There are many ways in which you and I can guard the health of our hearts. The Bible teaches that what is true in the physical realm is also true in the spiritual realm. The word heart appears over 900 times in the Bible. And in Scripture, the heart is understood to be the life-giving source of our being. It is the inner source of energy and direction. James Harnish describes the human heart as the mission control center that determines our desires, that fires our passions, that frames our values, and energizes our will. He then likens the Bible to a kind of divinely inspired ECG machine that not only diagnoses what has gone wrong with the human heart, but also prescribes its cure. When it comes to our physical hearts, there's a specific type of heart disease called cardiomyopathy. With cardiomyopathy, the heart muscle becomes rigid and so unable to pump blood through the body. And the surgical cure for cardiomyopathy is a heart transplant. Through the Old Testament prophet Ezekiel, God spoke about a spiritual heart transplant as the cure for spiritual cardiomyopathy. When God said, "I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh." In fact, throughout Scripture, spiritual cardiomyopathy is seen as being a central concern of God's. Jesus diagnosed this condition when he quoted Isaiah, "For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes. Otherwise they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them." The Wesleyan revival that birthed the Methodist Church began in the human heart. In 1738, a stuffy, intellectual, deeply devoted Anglican priest went dragging his heels to a Bible study group. And during that study, he felt his heart strangely warmed. The faith that he had studied, believed, and taught, all head stuff, all intellectual, it kind of became a transformed fire in his heart. And at its best, Methodism has always emphasized the importance of the human heart set on fire by God's love. You might know the line of one of Charles Wesley's hymns, the prayer that says, "Kindle a flame of sacred love on the mean altar of my heart." In the Bible, heartburn is not an ailment. It's the sign of a healthy heart. Now, precisely because the health of our spiritual hearts either makes or breaks our lives with God, the writer of Proverbs urges us to prioritize the health of our spiritual hearts. Listen to verse 23 of today's reading. "Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it." That's Proverbs 4, verse 23. Your number one priority, Proverbs tells us, above all others, is to guard your heart, to protect your hearts. And why is that? Because everything you do flows from it. Just as a healthy heart leads to a healthy body, so a healthy spiritual heart leads to a spiritually healthy person. Now, just as a cardiologist will tell you the specifics of how to guard the health of your hearts, so the writer of Proverbs tells us very specifically how we should go about guarding our spiritual hearts, making sure that they remain healthy. And so today we're going to dive into Proverbs 4 to discover some very practical ways in which you and I can guard our spiritual hearts. First, Proverbs 4 tells us that we guard our hearts by giving attention to what enters our ears. We guard our hearts by giving attention to what enters our ears. My son, says Proverbs 4 verse 20, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ears to my words. Now, Proverbs was written in an oral culture in which all information from other human beings came as audio. It came through the ears by hearing. Since the invention of the printing press and then the invention of film and the internet, we now receive information via the written words and via video. But regardless of how information enters our consciousness, the principle is the same, that the first and foremost way in which we can guard our hearts is by determining what wisdom we will allow to guide us, what wisdom we will allow to enter into our hearts and guide us. The first rule of computer programming is known as GIGO, which stands for garbage in, garbage out. And it's a reminder that no matter how powerful a computer is, the output from that computer will never exceed the quality of the computer software that is loaded onto it. If the input is rubbish, the output will be rubbish too. And so as people who prioritize the health of our spiritual hearts, we should give attention to what information we feed our hearts. There's a lot of junk food out there in the world of information, isn't there? A lot of junk food on social media and on streaming services and on television. Junk food is nice, but it's not terribly good for our hearts, is it? So let me ask you, are you feeding your hearts with the wisdom that comes from God? Are you giving attention to the study of Scripture as a way of feeding your heart with good food? Are you feeding your heart with that which is, in the words of Philippians chapter 4, true, noble, right, pure, lovely, and admirable? And are you carving out time to eat the healthy words of Scripture? Are you allowing the truths of Scripture to sink down deep into your heart and to take root there? Are you guarding your ears from that which is toxic? Gossip, which assassinates another's character? Racist or sexist talk, which dehumanizes others? News, which is overly negative? You and I get to decide what we will turn our ears to, what we will tune our ears to, what we will allow to sink in and to settle in to our hearts. We guard our hearts by giving attention to what enters our ears. Second, we guard our hearts by keeping our eyes on God's vision for our lives. Verse 25 of Proverbs 4 says, "Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you." You know, one of the realities of our human condition is that we are so easily distracted, aren't we? Anyone who has ever achieved anything worthwhile, whether it be on the sports field or in the workplace or as a volunteer or in academia, knows that there is a single-mindedness, a focus on the goal that is ahead, that is essential if you are going to achieve any worthwhile goal. And it's the same with the spiritual life. We need to keep our eyes on the goal of our life with God. The columnist Ellen Goodman, writing in a New Year's Day column, once wrote this. She said, "We spent January 1 walking through our lives room by room, drawing up a list of work to be done and of cracks to be patched. But maybe this year, to balance the list, we ought to walk through the rooms of our lives, not looking for flaws, but for potential." And vision is about discerning not just the flaws in our lives, but discovering the potential that God calls us to strive for. And we'll never grow spiritually unless we have a clear vision of what a spiritually mature person looks like. Dallas Willard painted a lovely vision of the goal of the spiritual life. He said that Christian growth is is the spirit-driven process of forming the inner world of the human self in such a way that it becomes like the inner being of Christ himself. Forming the inner world of the human self in such a way that it becomes like the inner being of Christ himself. And that's our vision as we seek to guard our hearts, to allow the Spirit so to form our inner world that it will become like the inner world of Jesus Christ himself. And so we guard our hearts by keeping our eyes on God's vision for our lives. The third thing we do is that we guard our hearts by carefully choosing the path we walk in. By carefully choosing the path we walk in. Listen to verse 26 and 27. Give careful thought to the paths for your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or the left. Keep your foot from evil. So once we have a clear vision of where we need to go, the scripture says it's important that we remain on the path that will get us there, that is pointing in that direction. If our goal is to become like the, for our inner world to become like the inner being of Christ himself, then it's going to be important that we do those things that will enable that to happen. And so I want to ask you, are you giving your time and your talents and your treasures in such a way that your selfishness and your materialism is becoming neutralized? Are you serving others in such a way that your pride is being replaced by a Christ-like humility? Are you slowing down from a rushed life such that there is space for you to hear the still small voice of God? Are you walking down a path that will take you closer to the vision that God has for your life? We guard our hearts by carefully choosing the path we walk in. Fourth and finally, we guard our hearts by keeping our speech pure. By keeping our speech pure. Verse 24 of Proverbs 4 says, "Keep your mouth free of perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips." Now, usually when the Bible talks about the relationship between our hearts and our words, it goes to great pain to explain that it is our hearts that shape our words and not the other way around. I mean, listen to what Jesus said in Luke chapter 6, verse 45. He said, "A good person brings good things out of the good stored up in their heart, and an evil person brings evil things out of the evil stored up in their heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of." And whilst this is primarily true, there is also a sense in which our words are powerful to influence our hearts as well. The flow goes both ways. We can choose in our conversations with others what we are going to focus on. Are we going to focus on words that are going to break others down or belittle others? Are we going to choose to be perverse in our conversation, or will purity mark our words? Our words can be dishonest and deceptive, or they can be truthful and revealing to others. And what about the words that we speak to ourselves? Let's be honest, they say the first sign of madness is talking to yourself, but we all talk to ourselves, don't we? Or am I the only one who is mad? Certainly the psalmist spoke to himself. Listen to the words of Psalm 42, verse 5. Where he says, "Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." And so there's this scriptural example of speaking words of truth and encouragement to our hearts and to our souls, to the center of our beings. Some time ago, I was asked to be a panelist in a panel discussion before a large audience on a controversial topic. And I was pretty nervous. You know, the thing about the panel discussions is, no matter how hard you prepare, you never know which way the conversation's going to go and whether you'll be put on the spot or not. As the time for the discussion grew nearer and my anxiety in my heart grew, the conviction also grew in me that I needed to speak to my heart, to counsel my heart. And so I said to myself, "Ian, you just go in there and you speak with integrity. You share your journey, you share your perspective, and why don't you try and have some fun as you go about it as well? My heart listened to that counsel that came from my own lips, and it stilled my anxious heart. And the conversation ended up being life-giving and revealing and even a little bit fun. So friends, we've been talking about lots of different body parts today, haven't we? We started off talking about the heart, which in the Bible is the life-giving core of our being. And we acknowledge that because of the risk of spiritual heart disease, which is usually fatal, we need to guard our hearts. And then Proverbs 4 suggested or mentioned four different body parts, which are metaphors for four different ways in which you and I can guard our hearts. Firstly, we pay attention to what enters our ears. And then secondly, we keep our eyes on God's vision for our lives. Thirdly, we carefully choose the paths our feet walk in. And finally, we keep our speech pure. And now I'll hand over to John, who will lead us in a time of reflection.
Thank you, Ian, for reminding us that our hearts are important and need to be carefully guarded. And thanks for giving us such clear guidelines to keep our hearts healthy. Friends, as we respond to what God has said to us today, I invite you to hold a stone or some hard object in your hands. And as you feel the cold hardness, think about the things that cause our hearts to become calloused and hard. We all get hurt. We all go through trauma to a greater or lesser degree. We all get disappointed, disillusioned, and distressed. We all feel the need sometimes to close ourselves and protect ourselves, or so we think, by hardening our hearts. So what are the things that have hardened your heart and caused spiritual cardiomyopathy? What parts of your heart are scarred, calloused, bruised, and hardened? Take a moment now and invite the Spirit to reveal any areas in your life where your heart needs healing, softening, and restoration. And now I invite you to lay down your stone and invite the Spirit to heal and soften your heart. If you need to speak a word of forgiveness over someone, do it now. Or if you need to confess some part that you have played in making your heart hard, offer your confession to God now. As you do this, open your hands as a sign of opening to the heartwarming Spirit of God. Finally, think about what you will do specifically and practically this week to guard your heart. How will you pay attention to what enters your ears? How will you keep your eyes on God's vision for your life? What path will you choose for your feet to walk on? How will you keep your speech pure? And now let's offer our hearts wholeheartedly to God as we sing.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord. I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul. I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. This is my desire, to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul. I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul. I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your way in me.
And so we come to the end of our worship practice for today. Thank you so much for joining us. As we close, let's greet one another with open and loving hearts. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. And now let's guard our hearts as we go into this week, so that we may remain healthy and share goodness and love with those around us. Have an open-hearted week, and God bless you.